Wait, is there a pastor?
Yeah. It's my dad. The pastor's right.
Anybody from Orangeburg?
Just kidding. So Orangeburg was a very small town. I was kind of what I consider to be a big fish in a small town because I went to a small private school. And so even if there were a lot of talented people, they were too shy to try out. So I felt kind of like I had a little bit of an advantage to trying out for the spring musicals and drama club. And I did everything that I could because I was not athletic at all. Like, talking like I was the only one that was not chosen for the JV basketball team. Like, just choose me and let me sit on the bench, right? No, they weren't that kind. And academically, you know, I mean, I just wasn't my thing either. But of course, I'm pretty sure that was because I was too busy talking in class, you know. So really, my outlet was theater. My parents got separated 4 times from the time that I was in the third grade to my senior year in high school, and theater was my outlet. It was just where I went. I could be someone else. I could escape the messiness of life. I could just be me, even though I really wasn't being me. Does that make sense for you theater majors? How many theater majors do we have? All right, awesome, y'all. So you know that feeling, right? I'm not by myself here. Or any arts, it's an escape, but it's also a reality. So, and it's a real gift that you've been given. So, all the way through, loved theater, loved plays, loved everything. Got to my senior year, and my guidance counselor said, "Why don't you try out for the theater scholarship at Commerce College?" And I was like, "Hey, okay." And I did, and I got it. And so I came here with high hopes and big dreams, and had some unfortunate stuff happen with my family my freshman year in college, and felt very insecure about my life at that point, and was very intimidated by all the other talented females at Converse at the time. And again, none of this was on Converse, none of this was on those females, it was on me. It was my own personal fear and intimidation, it was me. And while we're at it, this is not what I came here to talk about, but I just feel like I should. Everybody in this room has been given a gift and a talent, and some of you more than others, and some of you different than others. So, where I'm kind of getting at is don't let anybody else's sparkle dimmer your shine, because I let that happen my freshman year and I missed out on some rewards because of it. So don't compare yourself to somebody else because everybody else has been given something uniquely special. So I just kind of want to say that. I might hear preach, but I might preach. So moving forward, I ended up, because of all those fears and intimidation and insecurity, I ended up switching my major to marketing. And I kind of took a little bit of time off from theater, kind of declined the scholarship, or really, I'm not sure if I declined it or if it was taken away because of my lack of participation. And so I flipped majors to marketing, did all my marketing classes. Some of those were really hard for me, accounting, math, accounting. Just not my strong suit, still not to this day, and that's why we have calculators is what I tell people. So I did all that, and took a little bit of time off from theater, and then when I was feeling healthy and happy and family stuff was getting better, I jumped back into theater for fun. And I really just took classes just to have a good time and just kind of realized that maybe that was not the time of my life to be in it. So fortunately graduated from Commerce, and can anybody take a guess? No guesses? Y'all are gonna think. 1999.
I was so much younger.
Oh, really? Oh, I'm 40, so this is fun. I love y'all. I'm going to stay here. Honey, I'm not coming. So, anyways, graduated 1999, went out into the working world, like, what am I going to do with a marketing major and my love for theater, and ended up at an IT recruiting firm. Y'all don't do that. If you're arts people, do not go recruit for information technology. It is so boring. It is not you, okay? And it was not me either. Like, I was physically ill every Sunday night for 3 months. My mother called me and she said, "You have got to quit that job. It is tearing you apart." It was stifling. It was boring. It was not me. And but then I'm like, well, what do I do? And here come those insecurities and fears rushing back. When I left that company, y'all, I had an exit interview with 9 people. 9. And you know what one of them told me? "You know you're going to probably have like 7 jobs before you find the right one. Maybe you would be good at wedding planning," which there's nothing wrong with planning a wedding, girls. That is a hard job. But I'm just saying, like, he was real derogatory really made me feel, I loved wedding planning. I could not do it. One of my best friends does it, and it is way harder than one would think. But he was not saying it from that perspective. He was being real derogatory. And I was like, okay, so I left that job with my head down, the tail between my legs, and I go home and, you know, to my apartment with my two successful advertising agency roommates, and I'm like, I mean, I guess I just don't really know what I'm supposed to do or what I'm good at. You know, and I kind of had a little pity party, and my dad called me and said, pity party's over, you got to find a job. Like, we're not supporting you. You know? Boyfriend at the time was kind of like, my now husband was kind of like, honey, I mean, you got to do something like that, you know. And they were right. And so I went and interviewed with the Greenville News, this big multimedia news company in Greenville. And they're like, hire me on the spot. Can you start in 3 weeks? And I was like, sure. And as I'm walking out, this girl that I had met through a friend at Converse grabs me. And she's like, you don't want to do this job. She's like, you do not want to do this. You can do more than this. And so then I get home and I'm like, I've accepted the job, but I didn't feel great about it. You know, it was kind of like, I don't feel great about it. And here's the deal, y'all. Sometimes we don't feel great about it. Sometimes we have to do things we don't want to do to earn money. I mean, it's just the way it is. But so I get home and my very best friend that I live with, my successful advertising agency roommate and friend, she was like, oh, you know, I knew some people that left the Greenville News and started this other newspaper. Maybe I could get you in with them and use your resources, because a lot of times it is who you know to talk to get you in a door. So I said, well, I love interviewing them. Well, I went in and interviewed with the Greenville Journal. It's community journals now. They're multimedia, do tons of magazines and newspapers. And Greenville, Gville Today, I think we've got a Spartanburg Today in here. Do we have a Spartanburg Today? Spartanburg. I don't know. If not, I think it's coming soon, so maybe I shouldn't say that. But it's all kinds of digital and everything in print. But back then, y'all, print was cool. Like 1999, print was still, people were still picking up a newspaper. There were no iPhones, or at least, I don't think there were iPhones, were there? I didn't have one. I had a flip phone, and back when I had to get that flip phone, I was real sad. But anyway, so I had this job, and it was an inside sales, and they offered me the position, and I called my mom, and I said, okay, I've got this option between this big newspaper that's been around for 100 years, and I've got this smaller newspaper that's brand new, but it's like People Magazine, it's human interest, it's stories about, you know, somebody saving the cat in the tree, whatever it is. You know, I think I'm going to go with that one. And my mom's like, I'd go with the one that's been around forever. Well, I'm sure you would. And I said, well, I'm going to take a chance here. I like these people. I think that this is going to be a good opportunity for me. Plus, that other girl had said I wouldn't like them. And the Greenwood is great, by the way. They are good. But at the time, position. So, long story short, it's really not. It's just going to be a long story. I started the Greenville Journal. Sometime in 1999. It was still in the year, December of 1999. So all of this happened, y'all, with graduation. And isn't that crazy how much stuff can happen? So I start. They put me in inside sales. I'm selling classified ads, which is how you find a job or a car or a toaster oven, whatever, at the time in the newspaper. And I'm thinking I'm really good, and I'm the only one doing it. And come to find out, and two of our outside sales reps had left, and so my boss, who I loved, she was the most encouraging, still to this day, one of the people, she's just amazing. She comes to me and she goes, we need you to move into outside sales. So you're going to be going out and calling on businesses and selling advertising, and y'all, I started crying in her office. I mean, really, like, boo-hooing, like, I can't do this, I don't know. You know those insecurities? She said, get it together. I would not have put you in this position if I didn't think you could handle it, okay? And I was like, okay. She was like, you are one of the most outgoing people I know, Michelle. She was like, you have a knack with people, and you like people, and people might like you. Not everybody likes me, I know that. And, you know, like, just go out and be yourself and help people. And she said, help people. Ding, 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 ding. You know, that's what I want to do. I want to go help people. And so when she put it to me like that, she knew how to word it. She knew how to sell me. Thrived, and I'm not saying this to brag about myself, but I thrived off of every single minute of that job. I mean, there were some hard minutes, but I stayed in the newspaper and magazine industry for 9 years, way longer than I thought I would. I sold advertising, I met with businesses, I sat with people and came up with creative ideas, and I'm not even really like a visual artist, but I could draw out a campaign, and I've come up with slogans and sayings and fun stuff. I mean, just stuff that I didn't know I had in me, honestly, because, like, all I'd ever thought was theater. And so a lot of that stuff came from Commerce College, consumer behavior class, marketing 101, how to handle, there's an international business class, I don't know if it's still here, but how to business etiquette, how to sit across from somebody at a table and be respectful and learn to be quiet and listen to what they have to say. I mean, these were all things that my marketing major had taught me. And even though I kind of had to go through that bumpy road of the IT recruitment, all of a sudden I'm like, I'm seeing this and I'm thriving. So the whole time the South Carolina Children's Theater was my client. And so by meaning client, they would call me, I would hold the space for their advertising, I would go in and sit down with them and say, do y'all need some help deciding how often to run the ads? Do you need, what kind of campaign can we come up with? Do you need our graphic artist involved? To draw out the stuff, to whatever. And I guess it was probably about halfway through my journal career, I said, hey, to the marketing director, I said, if you ever leave, holler at me, because I want to come holler. Don't you like that word? I said, call me, because I would really be interested in this position. I said, now I need full time and I need benefits, and she was part time. And she was like, I'll let you know. Well, she did. She called me, I guess, probably my sixth year into the journal and said, I'm leaving. Do you want to set up the interview? And I was like, well, is it going to be part time or full time? She's like, it's part time. I'm like, yeah. I talked to my husband. We just can't swing that right now. I've got to stay full time. Okay. And so went on. Still my client. Still thrived. Had interviews with real estate companies. I mean, I kind of looked around, but not really. Only because I think sometimes you do that. You just kind of have to keep your eyes open because you never know if somebody's going to lay you off or if you're going to have a bad sales month. Like that was in my case, all the J months, January, July, June, were very hard sales months for advertising because people didn't really want to spend a lot of money advertising their stuff after Christmas. So I always kind of kept my eyes open. In fact, I interviewed for a position here in alumni relations, but then I realized I'd be driving a lot back and forth, and I was kind of ready to start a family, so didn't end up coming here. But so there are things along the way that happened. So about 2 or 3 years later, I get a call from the marketing director. She's like, look, we're going to make it full time. We want you. I was like, seriously? And then, of course, I started getting sad because I was so loyal to the journal and my manager there, my boss there, and all the friends that I had made there. And I mean, I grew up there. I started there when I was 22. I was 30 now. I mean, 31, actually. But they were making this full time, so I was going. I mean, I was like, you know what? This is such a gift. So I left and started at the theater. Almost 10 years ago, and in a full-time position, and I'll tell y'all more about that in just a minute. Then I got pregnant about 6 months later, who knew, with twins, and so, who knew, all these funny little things that are just great little plans that were not mine, that I'm so thankful for. But anyway, so after I went back, after maternity leave, my husband looked at me and goes, what do you want to do? We had one in the NICU for a month, so I was at the hospital every day. I essentially took a 15-week maternity leave because I was on bed rest for a few weeks, and this is all neither here nor there, but if y'all ever have babies one day, it is not easy either. So, So I say all that to say that all this time I had been waiting for this full-time position, and then basically a year later I was like, can I go part-time now? And she was like, and she said, of course you can. I said, honestly, I can do this. And if I can just take this one event off my plate, because I'm really not that great at it anyway, she's like, yeah. So I found somebody else to do it, and that really made the job part-time. So currently today, I am a part-time marketing director, but I do all of it. I mean, it's, I'll answer the phone later on this afternoon. So, you can be flexible. I work 8 to 1 Monday through Thursday. It is very ideal for me with my family situation. I'm a very big believer in a work-life balance. I'm a very big believer, for me at least, just to be the one who tells my kids no after school to something, because I'm a helicopter mom, so I'm just like that. So anyways, that is what's brought me here today, and I love what I do. I am so passionate about it. So I'm going to just share with y'all really quickly a video that tells you what the Children's Theater does, if you don't already know, and hopefully, if you're like me, brings a little tear to your eye. So, all I do is click, right?
Yeah,
I am so terrible at y'all are waiting.
Yeah.
Okay.
Here we go.
Here we go. strongest introduction ever. The last roll to him.
Are you nervous?
Yeah, a little bit. I'm always a little bit nervous, but that's a good thing.
Why?
Toes when you're breaking a leg.
Okay, everyone, it's showtime.
Backstage is a thrilling place to be. Bonds are formed, lessons are learned, and courage is found. Backstage is a thrilling place to be. Bonds are formed, lessons are learned, and courage is found.
Our main stage is exciting. It's wonderful. But we're also so very proud of the things that are going on off the stage, and that is in our education classes and our outreach. The impact that we're able to make on a child in those two areas of our mission is what makes the children's theater special. In our classroom settings, we teach children ages 3 to 18. In our younger children's classes, it's often play and pretend. For the older kids, we are providing an opportunity to have a curriculum-based program that can take them up a ladder to another theatrical opportunity, or they can be here just having fun.
It has built up my confidence way more. And I can talk to people now. I'm not scared to like order at a restaurant. And it's grown me as a person a lot.
It's a broadening experience for the children. It helps them to grow up, but they also get to enjoy pretending and being another character, so they also get to enjoy being children as well. I'm always proud of them.
We believe so strongly in the power of theater and that all children should get to participate in that. We take our programs to at-risk, disadvantaged, special needs, or hospitalized children.
Our school has been fortunate enough to participate in an 8-week residency. We have a student who suffers from severe anxiety, but through this program, she has gotten very comfortable standing up, speaking up. So to me, that speaks volumes about what this program can do for other children.
Children at the third and fourth grade level are starting to face more complicated issues. We want to show them how to prevent bullying, how to define it, how to communicate it, and how to handle it effectively. They see the production, and it brings it to life. It brings bullying to life. It's fun, it's engaging, but it's still communicating a powerful message to our children in a serious manner. But they're able to have some takeaway tools, which is more important.
Every child is able to perform. Every child has the ability to be creative. Tell Me a Story Theater allows those children to express themselves and explore their creativity and imaginations and then bring it to life in front of their grown-ups. Almost every year, a parent will come up to me with tears in their eyes and say, I didn't know that my child could be so normal.
A gift of land combined with our current property and grit.
What we do as a whole. We don't just do plays and main stage shows. We do a lot of outreach, which is so important. I think sometimes people think, oh, well, you're theater and everybody's all about their role and their thing, but we're not. I mean, our goal at the Children's Theater, y'all, is to make sure that every underserved child in Greenville and the upstate gets a chance to be exposed to theater arts. So that's a huge mission for us. One of the things we do is the Meyer Center for Special Children is a school in Greenville. Is anybody familiar with the Meyer Center? It's a school in Greenville for special needs children. A lot of these kids are in wheelchairs. A lot of them have Down syndrome. A lot of them have trachs set up. They can't eat or talk or, you know, laugh. And we do a graduation program for them every year. And I'm just getting right on to outreach just while we're on it. But we do a graduation program. So when these children graduate, there's usually about 10 to 12 graduates. Their parents all come, just like y'all are, with their video cameras, watching their child walk across and get their diploma to move on to mainstream schools because they're ready to go. But we do The Little Engine That Could, which is an extremely encouraging book to teach them. And y'all, they are wheelchairing and walking and clapping and singing. We do Pete the Cat. Y'all are probably young enough, like your parents, right? Y'all Pete the Cat, didn't they? maybe not? Okay. That felt flat, so flat. So anyways, that is a huge thing. We go to CDS, Center for Developmental Services. We go to Marshall Pickens, which is children who have been severely neglected or abused by family members. And we bring them. I mentioned to y'all earlier that theater could be an escape. To see some of these kids, y'all, that walk in and are just, you know, like head in the shoulder and just so sad, come to life on a stage, it is the coolest thing I've ever seen. So my job is, you know, my job's not rocket science, y'all. It's not. I mean, and really when you figure it out, when you are doing something you love, it's really not that hard. So I get paid, fortunately, to do something I love. And so that's really what I'm going to talk to y'all about in terms of everything that I do. And y'all can read, but I'll kind of elaborate a little bit. So as the marketing director, I handle all aspects of marketing, promotions, PR, and advertising. So at the beginning of the season, we just announced our 2018-2019 season. So what I did yesterday before I left the office was I sent our graphic artist the names of the shows and some images of things that I liked, and she draws all the art for the season, and she does the titles, and then she sends it back to me, and my executive director, also a Commerce graduate, by the way, she's been at the theater the whole time, she and I kind of mull over it. We go, yeah, I don't like that, or I really like that, that looks cool. And then once we agree, and she draws it all out, every single marketing material that we do for the whole season is done about the same time. So I do a season brochure that goes out to all of our audience. I do postcards for each show. We have 5 main stage shows. Those are the big shows that we do at the Peace Center. We do postcards, we do posters, we do school flyers that go into the schools. We do PR cards, which is the card, that has everything that we do on it. I get all that stuff printed at one time because being a nonprofit is cheaper to go to a printer and say, if I give you all this stuff ready at once, can you print it? And y'all, one time I printed Peter Pan's posters with like a June date, and it was in September, and it was just awful. It was, $400 to print those posters, and so I have to be very detailed. detailed and proofing all these things. And once you've seen the stuff 100 times, you're kind of like, it's like writing the word cat down and then like staring at it and going, is that the CPT how you spell cat? I mean, you know, you start kind of overanalyzing everything. So that's an area that, you know, not being more of a excited about my job thing and not really detail oriented so much was a big thing. Proofreading was a big thing for me. So I do all the materials, get that all done, get that all together, all the ads for the newspapers. I write the radio spots, which is really fun. Basically from start to finish, I don't direct the shows and I don't teach the kids classes, but I do get to be really involved with that. I get to take the characters on appearances. So I'll call YFF or WSPA, Fred Cunningham here in Spartanburg. He interviews all my characters, and that's so fun. And Fred's daughter was involved. And so I take him to all the appearances. I pitch all the story angles, anything cool. Like, for example, my intern that I work with, she is special needs. And when she was born, she was not supposed to live one day. She's 32. She has one of those traits that I was talking about. She can't speak, but she uses her iPad to communicate with me. She first of all said that when she did the Cinderella in high school, that was the first time she had ever had real friends in her whole life, was because of South Carolina Children's Theater and just the camaraderie that theater and being in a show together can bring. I mean, you can take all kinds of different people from all walks of life and you put them in a show together, and that's a bonding experience. You know, I'm sure some of y'all know that already. Musicians, I'm sure you know that too. You know, your instrument might not sound as good for that song without the instrument next to you, right? I mean, you're not in a show by yourself, so you need these people. So anyways, but I pitched the story to the newspaper. I said, you know, Stephanie was not supposed to live a day. She's 32 now. She's going to be in the Wizard of Oz. She stopped growing when she was 11 years old. So can y'all do a story in her? And the newspaper loved that. And it's not exploiting Stephanie because Stephanie loved it. But it's more to say, like, people with disabilities can do a show. You don't have to be, like, you know, major actress or actor to be in the show. So those are the type of things. I always try to find the story behind the story to pitch to the media. I manage the social media, and y'all, I'm kind of like at the older end of managing social media. Like, really, we could probably use somebody younger than me to come in and manage, but I love Facebook. I love Instagram. Facebook's for old people, I know. But I don't do Snapchat. I'm like, well, it's going to go away in like 45 seconds. I mean, what is that? How the hell let me sell a show, you know? But the kids use it, which is good. The actors use it, the youth use it, so that's good. So I purchase all the media, I buy all the advertising for the shows, for the events, I push all of our classes. We do over 60 summer camps. We have four semesters. We do summer camps that go all year long, over 60 of them in the summer. We do a fall semester, we do a winter semester, which is a shorter term, and then kind of like Converse, and then we do a spring semester. So like she said in the video, we serve children ages 3 to 18, and it's amazing. The classes are set by age appropriate. All of our actors, by the way, are age appropriate actors. We don't have, like, you know, 4-year-old Tom playing Daddy Warbucks. We've got, like, Daddy Warbucks, like 50-year-old man playing Daddy Warbucks. So that's a big thing for us, too. A lot of times there's a misconception with children's theater that we're, like, cardboard boxes set up, and we've got real sets. We have real set designers, lighting designers, crew. In fact, I'm kind of dressed like the crew today. That's what I was thinking. I'm wearing my all black. They don't wear these necklaces and the leopard print shoes, but, you know, so we've got crew. We've got everybody. I assist in planning our major fundraisers. We do this awesome fundraiser called the Character Breakfast. It's next weekend. We do it once a year. We have over 600 family people coming to two different seatings. My biggest nightmare every year is that the balloons are going to be, like, all on the table the next morning. So y'all, you know, if we got any praying people in here, y'all pray about the balloons for me, because I can't. It really keeps me up at night. This is like our major prop. We put it in this pot with these apples. So anyways, that's next weekend, and y'all, that is so cool. We have 35 characters come in. They do a character parade. The kids are just so excited. We have, you know, all the Disney princesses. I mean, we got Tiana, Cinderella, Belle. They're all, I mean, and the kids just love it. All the little girls dressing their princess costumes, and, you know, it's just a lot of fun. And then we we also do outreach for that. So we bring in, we have people who sponsor the tables for a lot of our outreach folks so that children can come in. And we have, actually, we have separate rooms so that wheelchairs can come in and do all that. So that's just to see their faces. That is like the coolest thing ever. And that is our major fundraiser. And then what else do I do? I plan, I accompany the actors to the premieres. I see I've been skipping around. I just started talking and didn't do. Opening night special events. That is so fun. So we did Rapunzel a couple of years ago. And I was like, you know, I mean, like I said, when you tell me that I can help people, that's just such a personal mission for me. So I was like, well, why don't we do like a Wigs for Kids type thing? And so I did this big promotion with Wigs for Kids where anybody who was cutting their hair, and I started it way early so that people had time to grow their hair out if they hadn't already planned to grow their hair out. But y'all, we got more bags of hair. And then I gave them a free ticket to the show. They brought me their hair because they're already getting the benefit of helping give a wig for a child. But it was so cool. I mean, people just love that kind of stuff. So I'm always looking for ideas. Like one year we did Dr. Doolittle. And I went to the Humane Society and I'm like, let's do some kind of fun. So the Humane Society's come in before and brought animals for adoption. I mean, you adopt one or two animals, you're doing something good for the day. You know what I'm saying? And then what else? What are some other cool things? I did a whole, we did Disney's Mulan Jr. And I got together with the lady who was the head of this cultural something. And y'all, we had like the Japanese Alliance of the Upstate and the Chinese. I mean, we had all these awesome organizations, and they actually chose us for an award, and I was like, I was just trying to sell some extra tickets to the show, but this is great, but it provided more education, you know, make sure your motives are pure, guys. So, anyway, just some cool things like that. So those are some neat things.
We've got Michelle about 10 minutes, so if you want to share some photos or questions.
Oh, yeah, let me do that. Okay, I'm going to quickly get through. Bully program. This is one of our ways that we go into the schools in Greenville County. We have a show called The Boy Who Cried Bully. It is very good. They sing this funny song, Bully Bully, at the end of your family, maybe. Maybe your grandparents knew Bully Bully Bully. Anyways, we sing Bully Bully. We have a bully box that kids can go and write, I'm being bullied, and put it in there privately. The principal of the school will find them, will find the bully, and they'll make it right, okay? Which is very cool. How many suicides happen per year from bullying? We use real babies on our stage. This is from Sleeping Beauty, and that is Sleeping Beauty as a baby, just in case y'all were wondering. But you can see our costumes are extremely elaborate, the sets extremely elaborate. This is part of our outreach with Kinder Music. We take her, she goes in with instruments, with song. How many music therapists? We need musical. And y'all, this is awesome. I mean, music touches me in a million different ways, but I mean, you talk about these babies who have not moved, haven't sat there, all of a sudden they're moving, they're clapping, they're doing things they haven't done. Dabo Sweeney's All In Foundation gives to this, and I love Clemson football, so you know, I'm into that. And then finally, this is just one of our cool stage shows. Can anybody guess what show this is? But that kind of goes back with our set and our design, and just going and buying one of these. We got any lighting designers in here? What was this called back here? Do you know?
Star Drop,
right? Okay, see, oh, 10 years, and I'm like, that's not what I do. So, anyways, it costs a lot of money to buy one of those. And so, you know, as a nonprofit, we're writing grants, we're raising money. Right now, we're in the middle of the capital campaign. We're building our own theater that'll house all of our stuff, which is really, really cool. We've raised a lot of money. I can't tell you how much yet. It's still private, but it's a lot. And so, you know, we're in the midst of that. And it's just a lot of fun. I like what I do. You can tell. I'm a little spastic. But I think it takes spastic sometimes to get people excited about stuff. You know, I mean, how could you not be excited about Fred coming? You know, or Wizard of Oz. But there are some shows that the audience just, I mean, the patrons just don't seem to love. I mean, you know, we have some off seasons. Not many, but anyways. All right, Q&A. Time for questions. Oh, don't do that to me, y'all. Somebody just asked me.
If you're building your own building, where are you now?
Okay, so right now, all of our main stage shows are held at the Peace Center Gunner Theater. Peace Center is the basically Broadway, you know, so they have residences. without being in the hefty rehearsal schedules and without having all these new audience members, is basically families only are invited. Then we have We Play, which goes even littler, and y'all, it's so cute. Babies are coming up and they're crawling around, getting in the show. It is so fun. So, and then we have Kinder Music, which is what y'all just saw. So right now we're in 5 different locations because, you know, until we get this new building. So it's kind of confusing, but this is all kind of new this year too. We're getting ready to tear down the old one. We're going to build where we were. If y'all are familiar with Greenville, if you go down Augusta Street and you know where Monkeys or Pink Bee or any of those West End, in the West End, there's a modular building right now. And there's land next to it, and that'll be where we are. Hopefully 2020. All right. Anybody else? Did I talk more about me or the theater?
It really is.
It's a balance.
Oh, yeah.
Hi. Okay. So I know you said that you were a marketing major and that you're really into theater. I'm a music and accounting double major.
Oh, wow.
So how do you, like, get a job in, with both of them? Like, how did you end up there?
I know. I mean, like, I think that's the thing. Like, it wasn't directly out of college. You know, I think sometimes that might, don't ever think anything's too good to be true. This is not always. But I think finding the areas, like, so for example, my boss, who is, she was a psychology major here. She actually did the books for the theater. Now she runs the theater. So she has all that accounting background, which I'm so jealous, by the way. I can't keep the balance. Anyway, but that, so I guess trying to find, maybe going to a place like the symphony, like the Greenville Symphony, for example, and saying, hey, I'd love to help plan y'all's budgets and do your books. How about that? Does that make sense?
Yes.
I mean, so go somewhere that you get to hear the music and be a part of the music, or even be in, and then, you know, that you can do the business side. Every organization needs good business people. If I was running the theater, we would be out of business. Because I'm not budget. I didn't even mention that I do the budget. Y'all, that's how bad I am. My boss is, is this right? Just give me the same amount I had last year for marketing, and I won't change a thing, but that's not how it works. So, anyway.
Did you do any marketing? Well, I was going to ask with the newspaper. Right?
Yes.
You mentioned you did stop like doing campaigns.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I would wake up in the night and I would have a gym that I'd be working in. And the name of the gym was the Sports Club. It's still over there. And I would have a whole campaign in my mind about, and I would use alliteration. I would use the S, the first letter of S, and I would come up with a campaign that I would go and call the client. I'm like, I think y'all need to do this. I can see a series of messages gearing towards health. Or I'd go into a store and I'd say, oh my gosh, I think that lamp would be fabulous. I'm gonna do the ad in the shape of a lamp, and then we'll have it in your business right there, and then we'll put this stuff there, and we'll have your call to action there. Like, turn the lights on, or whatever it would be. I'm very cheesy. I do come up with very cheesy headlines and things, but y'all, it works. When I send that to the newspapers, they're like, great, we'll do a story. I mean, but it's sincere too, you know? Does that help?
Yes. Did you do anything with internships at all before you went into your job?
Well, I'm going to tell y'all, y'all are so much further ahead than I am. I was a big, hot mess in college. That's what I'm saying. I'm like looking at y'all going, they know how to do websites and blogs, and I still don't even know how to like set up a PowerPoint. I mean, for real. So my internship I did with a real estate agent. And, you know, I learned and I liked it. I really did, but because I got to talk to people. I mean, I think you find, you know what you kind of know where you're comfortable sometimes. And, you know, we're called to be uncomfortable sometimes too. But I think you find you kind of dig deep when you're looking for, dig deep. You know, don't just think, oh, well, this is what I've always done. Dig a little bit deeper, because if you had told me that I could go out and sell advertising and help people promote campaigns, and I just told Dr. C, I just started writing a blog a couple weeks ago. And I was like, I didn't know I was a writer. And somebody's like, well, you do write all the press releases and the stories for the theater. I'm like, yeah, but that's for work. I mean, I didn't know the first thing I could, you know, so it's, and I'm 40, so we're constantly evolving as women into, you know, don't pigeonhole yourself into one thing. I told y'all I'd get preachy. But just, you know, because right behind that gift is another gift, you know? Does that make sense? Does that answer the question?
Yes. Well, two things. I think we would love, just a few people don't have to immediately run away. If a few folks would stay, we would love to get a photo with Michelle as an alum.
Right.
And Michelle,
this is my first lecture.
course.